Tayo po'y manalangin. Heavenly Father, we acknowledge you that you are our great and true God. Thank you for loving us unconditionally. Thank you for forgiving our sins and always giving us many chances na makabangon sa amin po mga shortcomings and weaknesses. Thank you for always giving us the opportunity to come unto you, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, we lift up unto you once again ang pinagdadaanan po ng aming bansang Pilipinas, maging ang buong mundo na dumaranas ng pandemya. Pagalingin mo po ang mga na-affect ng COVID-19, maging ang new variant nito. Patuloy mo pa rin palakasin ang aming po mga frontliners. Father, may you please intervene in our government. Touch every heart of the officials na magkaroon po sila ng pagkakaisa sa isang layunin para sa aming bansa, lalo po sa mga mamamayan po namin. Loobin mo rin po na ma-encounter ka ng mga aming po mga government officials, Lord, sa buhay po nila. Father, we commit unto you our online worship. Bless all the worship participants, those who will lead the singing. Bless their hearts and anoint their voices. Bless the editing and multimedia team with wisdom, more ideas, and creativity. Bless our speaker for today, Pastor Jun Mayor. Fill him with your wisdom and anointing, Lord. And bless your people who will listen. May you open our hearts and mind, Lord, and give us the willingness to be corrected and enlightened by your word. Please guide us in everything we do, especially all the members of GCF Montalban na dumaranas ng mga sirkumstansya sa buhay. May your protection and provision be upon all of us, Lord. Bless our pastor, Arnel Aristoteles, and his family. May your favor and covering be always upon them. Provide all their needs, Lord, and keep them safe and in good health. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
We pray that today's message will strengthen your faith. If this happened, we love to hear your story. Send your story to our FB page or you may send it to our personal messenger. If you want to pray for or want to ask spiritual guidance, or would like to join a Bible study group or discipleship group, just message us at GCF Montalban FB page. Or you may direct your concern to Brother Carlo Asilo or to Pastor Arnel G. Aristoteles. If this ministry has blessed you and if you want to support this ministry financially, you may give your tithes and offerings through online transfer or you may deposit it to our Banco de Oro account with account name GCF Inc. and with account number 01022800-6618. You may also give your tithes and offerings to Palawan Express, Western Union, Cebuana Lulier, M. Lulier, or LBC Padala under the name of Carlo Asilo. Brother Carlo will deposit your sent money to our church BDO account and will send back the copy of deposit slip to you for accountability purposes. Again, may the Lord bless you as you listen to the message today.
Our scripture passage is found in 1 John chapter 4, verse 16. And so we know and rely on the love of God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. May the Lord bless the reading of His word.
A blessed Sunday to everyone. Today is the first Sunday of the month of February. February is known as the month of love. In light of this, we will devote our sermon series for this month on the topic of love. But we'll not be talking about love as the world knows it, but according to how God and the scriptures define it. We'll be talking about the love nature of God, responding to His love, loving fellow believers, and loving the lost in the month of February. This topic has probably been preached numerous times. What would be the value of revisiting the topic again? Well, part of getting intimate with someone who is knowing the other person better. What we should want to develop intimacy with God. Also, having a right knowledge of God will enable you to have a sound theology and will allow you to relate more correctly with Him. Knowing about His love for you and me will also make you appreciate and love Him more. As you understand the greatness of the love of God, you should be able to gain insight on how you can improve in loving Him and others. Today, we'll talk about some of the most important characteristics of the love of God. How different is God's love from that of man? Let us begin to know God and His love. To start with, the Bible declares that God Himself is love. 1 John 4:16, God is love. What does it mean that God is love? Well, love is an attribute of God. Love is a core aspect of God's character, His person. Everything God does is loving, just as everything He does is just and right. God is the perfect example of true love. If we look at how the Bible describes love, then we will see a few ways in which God is the essence of love. 1 Corinthians 13 verses 4 to 8 says this, "Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails." This is God's description of love. And because God is love, this is what He is like. Love does not force itself on anyone. Those who come to God do so in response to its love. Love shows kindness to all. Love, as seen in the life of Jesus, goes about doing good to everyone without partiality. Love did not covet what others had, and indeed Jesus lived a humble life without complaining. Jesus did not brag about who He was in the flesh, although He could have overpowered anyone He ever came in contact with. Love does not demand obedience. God did not demand obedience from His Son, but rather Jesus willingly obeyed His Father in heaven. Jesus is always looking out for the interest of others. Amazingly, God has given those who receive His Son Jesus as their personal Savior the ability to love as He does through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now let's go on to the second attribute of God's love. God's love is eternal. The dictionary defines eternal as lasting for all time, without beginning or end. It can also mean endless or timeless. The Bible says that God is love. Since God is eternal, He has no beginning or end. His love is also eternal. Let us look at two verses that talk about the eternality of the love of God. First, the psalmist exhorts us. "Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His loving kindness is everlasting. Give thanks to the God of gods, for His loving kindness is everlasting." And then the prophet Jeremiah writes this, "The Lord appeared to him from afar, saying, 'I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have drawn you with loving kindness.'" The value of an article is due largely to how long it endures. Gold and precious stones, for example, are more precious than wood or paper, which do not last. God's love, or loving kindness, the term hesed, is rendered in Psalm 136, is everlasting. It is eternal. Can you imagine if the love of God can end anytime? He could suddenly lose his patience with us and tell us all of the sins that we have committed against him. He can bring out the record of all the wrong things that we have done. He can then choose to withdraw his favor and protection from us. Satan, who is our enemy, will then be able to destroy us. But thankfully, God will never do that because his love is never ending. Aren't you glad that his love is eternal? And then, God's love is infinite. The dictionary defines infinite as immeasurable. God's love is too deep to be measured. God's love is limitless. The psalmist knows this when he said, "For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his loving kindness toward those who fear him." God's love is unfathomable. It is too deep to understand. It is beyond the reach of human knowledge. Ephesians 3 verses 18 to 19 says this, "So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God." This mind-boggling aspect of the unfathomable love of God is seen when he chose to love us. Now, God does not love us because we're lovable or because we deserve his love. If anything, the opposite is true. The state of mankind since the fall is one of rebellion and disobedience. Jeremiah 17:19 describes man's inner condition. The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Our innermost beings are corrupted by sin, that even we don't realize the extent to which sin has tainted us. In our natural state, we do not seek God. We do not love God. We do not desire God. Romans chapter 3, verses 10 to 12 clearly presents the state of the natural person, the one who is not born again. "There is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one." How then is it possible for a holy, righteous, and perfect God to love such creatures? It is God's essential nature to love. He demonstrates his love by lavishing it on undeserving people like us who are in rebellion against him. God's love is not a sentimental, romantic feeling. Rather, it is agape love, the love of self-sacrifice. He demonstrates this sacrificial love by sending his son to the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. For all of eternity, we shall ponder the love of God, and never will we fully be able to comprehend it, for his love is infinite. And then, God's love is immutable. This means God's love is unchanging. The dictionary defines immutable as fixed, absolute, permanent, irreversible. How quickly human love can turn to hate in the divorce court. God's love is not like this. His love is unchanging. As God is immutable, so is his love. Prophet Micah has this to say about God's immutable love. "Who is a God like thee, who pardons iniquity and passes over the rebellious act of the remnant of his possession? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in unchanging love." James in the New Testament also recognizes the unchanging quality of God when He said this. Whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, who created all the light in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. Can you imagine if God can change His mind? What if He suddenly decides that it does not make sense to love us? After all, we tend to be rebellious and disobedient. What if He decides to stop protecting, caring, and providing for us? If you're a farmer, your field would be infested with pests or would be destroyed by floods or storms. If you are into business, your investments will not make any profits or your business will simply fail. If you are employed, your company might declare a bankruptcy and you could lose your job. Now, what if God decides to cancel our salvation because we're not worth saving? You and I should be glad that whatever God has ordained or decreed is permanent, because He is an unchanging God and His love is unchanging. And then, God's love is holy. 1 Samuel 2:2 says this, "There is none holy like the Lord. There is none beside Him. There is no rock like God." The holiness of God is the most difficult of all God's attributes to explain, partly because it is one of His essential attributes that is not shared inherently by man. God's holiness is what separates Him from all other beings, what makes Him separate and distinct from everything else. The dictionary defines holiness as being sanctified, set apart, or pure. God's holiness is more than just His perfection or sinless purity. God's holiness embodies the mystery of His awesomeness and causes us to gaze in wonder at Him. God's love is always an expression of God's holiness. It is also directed toward producing holiness in us. God's love seeks to make us holy. 1 Peter 1, "But as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, 'You shall be holy, for I am holy.'" God expects us to be holy. It is His calling for us, whom He has chosen a long time before we were even born. Ephesians 1:4, "Just as He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before Him." God's holy love for us is the reason why He disciplines us whenever we sin and walk away from Him. Hebrews 12, verses 5 to 10. "Have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by Him. For the Lord disciplines the one He loves and chastises every son whom He receives." It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline, in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time, as it seemed best to them. But He, God, disciplines us for our good, that we may share His holiness. And so, in love, God disciplines us, moving us in love toward holiness. The love of God is not a guarantee that we will not suffer. It is the assurance that whatever suffering we endure is directed toward making us holy by a God who loves us. If it was necessary for Christ to suffer in order to demonstrate God's love toward us, why would we think our suffering is incompatible with God's love toward us? And then, God's love is personal. God's love is directed towards the individual. It is a personal kind of love. He also wishes to cultivate a private and intimate relationship with specific persons. Now, does God love everyone or just Christians? Well, there is a sense in which God loves everyone in the whole world. As we read in John 3:16, for God so loved the world. Now, this love is not conditional. It is rooted in God's character and based on the fact that He is a God of love. God's love for everyone could be thought of as His merciful love, since it results in the fact that God does not immediately punish people for their sins. Your Father in heaven causes His Son to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous, the unrighteous. Matthew 5:4-5. This is an example of God's love for everyone, His merciful love, His benevolence extended to everyone, not just Christians. However, God's love for everyone does not mean that everyone will be saved. Those who reject Him will suffer eternity in hell. Does God love everyone? Yes, He shows mercy and kindness to all. Does God love Christians more than He loves non-Christians? No, not in regards to His merciful love. Does God love Christians in a different way than He loves non-Christians? Yes, because believers exercise faith in God's Son. They are saved. God has a unique relationship with Christians in that only Christians have forgiveness based on God's eternal grace. God's love is an exercise of His goodness towards individual sinners. The love of God that brings people into intimacy with Himself is not extended to everyone, only to those who love His Son, Jesus. This love could be thought of as God's covenantal love, and it is conditional, given only to those who place their faith in Jesus for salvation. Those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ love unconditionally, securely, forever. So God's love is personal. He knows each of us individually and loves us personally. His is a great love that has no beginning and no end. And then God's love is sacrificial. The dictionary defines sacrificial as costly, expensive, precious, lavish, valuable. God's love is not self-serving, but sacrificial. Love comes at a high cost. And the one who loves is the one who willingly pays the price. We are all familiar with the verse that talks about the sacrificial love of God. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. Now, referring to Himself, Jesus explained that the one who truly loves is even willing to give up his very own life for the sake of another. John 15:13, greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. Love always has a price tag, and the lover is gladly willing to pay the price. From eternity past, God set His love on us and purposed to save us through the sacrificial death of His Son. Now, let's talk more about this. Number one, God's love is expressed in Christ. In love, God provided a cure, a salvation not only for fallen men, but for a fallen creation as well. In love, God sent His Son to die on the cross of Calvary, bearing man's sins and offering to fallen men the righteousness of God. Those who receive the gift of salvation in Christ become the special objects of divine love. And then they begin to manifest this love toward others who live in a fallen world. The Apostle John explains how the love of God was demonstrated when He sent His Son to die for our sins. 1 John 4, by this the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent His only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through Him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. God's love to sinners was expressed by the gift of His Son to be their Savior. The measure of love is how much it gives, and the measure of the love of God is the gift of His only Son to be made man, to die for our sins, and so become the one mediator who can bring us to God. And then, God's love is seen in forgiveness. God's love is evidenced in the forgiveness of sins of those who repent of them. However, He will still punish those who do not repent of their wickedness. The Bible never gives a quote-unquote dictionary definition of forgiveness, but it shows us many examples of it. Although the following passage does not use the word forgive, it describes the concept of God's forgiveness perfectly. Psalm 103, the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will He harbor His anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed transgressions from us. God forgives sin, yet this does not mean that He simply looks the other way or sweeps it under the rug. The penalty for sin is death, and that penalty must be paid. God forgives people on the basis of the sacrifice of Christ. The only requirement is that sinful people confess their sin, turn from it, and trust in Jesus Christ, the Savior. Once a person has experienced the forgiveness of God, he or she is then able and responsible to forgive others. Colossians 3, verse 13. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. In the same way that God's love is seen through His forgiveness of our sins, our love for others can also be seen if we will learn to grant forgiveness to those who have sinned or offended us. Love should be a distinguishing mark of a Christian. Love, as defined in 1 Corinthians 13, should be seen in our lives. We should be more patient and more kind. We should be more selfless and more humble. We should be more caring. We should be more like Christ, because that is the desire of God for us. We should be able to love God and others better because God first loved us, and we have experienced His personal and sacrificial life of love through His Son, Jesus Christ. Now that you know the kind of love that God has for you, may you love Him more and appreciate Him more, and may you be more loving to other people as well. Shall we pray? Lord God, we thank You for Your love that is eternal, infinite, limitless, unfathomable, unchanging, and holy. Your love is beyond measure. We are grateful that Your love for us will never change. This gives us confidence in our relationship with You and in our eternal destiny as well. We thank You for loving us and for forgiving us our sins through the sacrifice of Your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. May our lives be a testimony of love to others around us, so that they too will be drawn to You and also experience Your amazing love firsthand. Make us instruments of Your love. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us for today's worship. Join us again next week for another lesson. If this service has blessed you, we would like to hear about it. Just send your stories. And if you want to support this ministry financially, message us at our GCF Montalban FB page. Once again, thank you. Have a blessed and fruitful week. God bless you.